Hey, City Church, it's so good to see you tonight. I'm glad you're tuned in. Look, reach out to all your friends. Let them know we're live. They're going to be blessed by the word tonight. You're going to be blessed by the word tonight. Look, the sun is shining. The birds are singing. We are getting breakthrough. I'm encouraging you tonight. Keep looking up. Stop looking down. God's got a purpose for your life. There's time to get your friends and your family to log in. Go on YouTube. Go on Facebook. We just want you to stay connected and be encouraged and inspired. Now we're going to go into some worship with Brandon and Alyssa Holt. Come on, get your praise on.
Are you ready to worship today? Come on, stand on your feet all across this place and let's give God the biggest shout of praise. If you know he reigns today, you ain't got nothing to worry about. Look at your neighbor, tell him, don't you worry, our God reigns. Come on, do you believe it? Let me see you clap like this. Woo! Come on. Put your hands together. Oh. Come on, let's sing to him today. Hey. And glorious, we put our trust in your name, Jesus, able to save and deliver us. We put our hope in your name, Jesus. Say blessing and honor, blessing and honor.
Yeah.
of our bellies and let it come out like, oh, come on, say,
oh.
Everything tremble, Jesus, just at the mention of your name. Demons have to flee, Lord. Blinded eyes are open. Oh, we bless you, Jesus. Come on, do you believe it today? Are you thankful for a mighty, powerful, holy name, the name of Jesus? Come on. Woo! We bless you, Lord.
Everything we have been blessed with comes from God. So when we give back a portion of what He's already blessed us with, it's an expression of our gratitude, obedience, and praise. It comes from a heart of worship that recognizes that He is first in our lives. God instructs us to give a tenth or a tithe, as it represents the first and most important portion of all that He's blessed us with. Thank you for planning your giving in advance. God loves a cheerful giver. There are a few ways that you can give. Visit our website at www.thecitychurch.co or visit pushpay.com/g/thecitychurchwindsor. Or you can download the City Church Windsor app from the Google Play Store or the App Store. Thank you for sowing into the kingdom. Please use this time to bless the Lord with His tithe and your offering while Bishop and Pastor prepare to bring us a word.
Wow, what an awesome worship. I am ready to enter into the presence of God. I hope you were blessed by it. We just thank God for all of our friends from all over the world that have just jumped in to help make this season an easy transition. And I want to take a minute just to thank all of our supporters, people from all walks of life, different situations, pouring into the kingdom of God, blessing the City Church, and all of our faithful members, you continuing to give faithfully and your tithe and your offering. Look, you know we're a church about evangelism, restoration, and education. We're about feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, taking care of the orphan and the widow. That is the mandate of our Savior, and we're following it. Because of you, we're able to reach those that are in need. And look, just because you are not on the front line, it's your seed that's being sown. You're changing lives. You're blessing people. It's not about me. It's not about Bishop. But it's all about what you're doing for the kingdom of God. Look, God never, He doesn't go rogue on us, and He always knows what you're doing. He watches your seed. So I want to encourage you tonight to keep giving, keep sowing into the kingdom of God, and it will come back to you. Press down, shaken together, and running over as we go into the word. How many are ready to be blessed by the word of God? Look, get your pens, get your papers, because when you're going through situations, a lot of times you don't have time to get to your computer and go back and watch this sermon again. But when you write it down, and you take notes, you get it hidden into your heart. And when you get it deep down in your heart, it will come back in those times of adversity. Listen, I had a coach who told me, train how you play. You're conditioning your body to respond. Listen, when you study the word of God and you prepare and you hide it in your heart, when life hits, when situations come, when you're put in an uncomfortable position, listen, it will kick in, it will come back, and it will guide you and lead you. The word of God will keep you. And so I want you to get your pens, your paper, as we're going to the word of God. Listen, get your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 27. We're going to start at the 27th verse. The book of Acts, chapter 27, the 27th verse. I'm going to read out of the NIV tonight, and it reads like this. On the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea, when about midnight, the sailors sensed they were approaching land. They took sounding and found that the water was about 120 feet deep. A short time later, they took sounding again and found that it was 90 feet deep. Fearing that we would be dashed against the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved." So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it drift away. Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat, For the last 14 days, he said, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head. After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of all of them. Then he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food for themselves. Altogether, there were 276 of us on board. And when they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lighted the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. And when daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach, where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they left them in the sea and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and made for the beach. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow struck fast and would not move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding surf. The soldiers planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to get there on planks or on other pieces of the ship. In this way, everyone reached land safely. Listen, I read that scripture and it just began to speak to my heart. Let me tell you, there's three types of storms we're going to talk about as we go through the Word of God. And in these three types of storms, there's the external storm, there's the internal storm, and then there's a spiritual storm that can hit our life. As these men were on this ship, did you take notice that it said that they didn't eat for 14 days because of the condition of the storm? So they became weak in their bodies. And Paul told them, before we delve into this thing, I want you to eat. I want you to bless it. He took what God gave him in front of all these men that didn't profess to be men of God, and he broke the bread and he gave thanks to God and ate before them. And it says that that one act of faith, that one act of faithfulness that Paul did, ministered to them so that they in turn were able to eat. When we hit storms, it can affect us not only mentally, it can not only affect us physically, but it can affect us spiritually. And you cannot deny that we've been going through some storms. But listen, I've been through worse storms than COVID-19. When you're dealing with your internal storms, nobody knows what you're going through. Those are some of the toughest storms. You can weather external storms, but when you deal with internal storms, it hits you in a way that nobody else can recognize. Only you know. And you know, there's a fear in that. There's a fear in going through a storm when you're all alone. So there's an external storm, there's an internal storm, and then there's a spiritual storm. But God did not intend for the storms that we face to destroy us, but he intended for the storms to prepare us and to navigate us and to direct us into our destiny. Listen, Paul wouldn't have went that way. You wouldn't go that way if you knew a storm was in front of you. If it was blue skies and birds singing, come on somebody, you'd be all in. Road trip, let's do this thing. But the moment you seen the sky rolling black and the wind pick up, you'd say, you know what? I'll catch you on the next one. So what God does is he hides those seasons from us so that we will go into a trusting with him that he will navigate us to get us to the point that we need to be. Not even knowing you need to be there, God knows where you need to be. How many believe he's sovereign today? Listen, I know my God is sovereign. The Word of God says he's the author and the finisher. That means that he writes the beginning and the end. You think Hollywood came up with filming the end first? God had it. God did it before they did. Listen, God knows your tomorrow. He's already in it. He's already preparing for it. So those are things we don't have to concern ourselves with. What we need to learn to do is navigate the storms. You need to learn how to navigate the storms of life so that you will not grow faint in heart. Listen, the men on that ship with Paul, they were ready to jump ship. How many people know there's people that jump ship? Things get rough, They start bailing like rats, jumping ship. Come on, somebody. But Paul told them, he said, listen, as long as you stay in this ship, you're going to stay safe. I'm going to give you an analogy of that. As long as you stay in the ship of Christ, you're going to stay safe. I told somebody this week, as long as we are in the ark of Christ, we don't have to worry about our tomorrow. Stay on the ship. Don't jump ship. Stay in the ship. Christ is our covering. He is our ship. So when you're facing those storms, you know, as long as I stay covered in Christ, I'm going to make it through. So it'll take some of that anxiety. It'll take some of that fear away from you. It'll take you from being distracted and get you focused, laser focused on the things of God. So again, what type of storms are there? Three of them, the external, the internal, and the spiritual. The storm is redirecting you. The storm is setting you up. Look at your neighbor and saying, this is a setup. You're being set up. And I know over the last few weeks, point number one, process. Why do Bishop and I keep hitting you with this word process? Because everything that God brings to you is a part of the process. We're all in a growing state, continually growing, continually maturing, continually going through process. If you go to a processing plant, that product is being processed, and as long as it's in the plant, changes are being made to it. It's being developed to be its best before it's shipped out. Come on, somebody. You have to understand that your life is a life of process. You're going to continually go through seasons, through changes, through shifting. Why? Because he said, this work which I began in you, I will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ. So this is not a one-time event. Salvation is not a one-time event. Salvation is a process because you're being transformed into the likeness of Christ. You're being transformed. Your character is being transformed. Your mind is being transformed. Listen, how would you like to have the same mind you had last year through your whole walk with Christ? I look back at the way I used to think about things, and it always comes back to me. My good friend, Pastor David Ennis, used to always say, that's stinking thinking. And I thank God that he delivered me from stinking thinking. Why? Because I washed my mind with the Word of God, and it began to be renewed through the process of washing with the Word. Everything has a process. So I'm not going to beat point one to death tonight, but I want you to get that. If this is your first time logging in, watching us, listen, process is not foreign to any of us. We're all going through it. We're all just handling it differently. We're all just identifying with our process differently. So what you have to do is recognize that this isn't a strange thing to anybody. We're all going through it. Process. Process has value. Listen, process is not, it doesn't care about what you think. That's the thing about process. It's not going to take your advice and say, well, do you think I should avoid you going through this pain today? No, process says you need to go through this to bring about change. It's going to hurt a little bit. It might hurt a lot. Depends how much you resist it. Listen, the more you kick and scream, the more painful it can be. But if you learn to rest in the process of God, trust God, then it's not so painful. I'm not going to say it's painless because then I'd be lying. And I'm not going to lie to you. I want you to have the truth of God. Amen? So there's value in process. You're going to lose people. You're going to lose things in process. You're going to lose some things you like to do in process. You're going to lose some people you like to hang around in process. You're going to lose not everybody you dislike, but God is going to disconnect you from some people that you're relying on him, on them more than you rely on him. And it may just be for a season that people come in and out of your life, but trust God in knowing that the process is going to bring about your perfecting. Process. It always brings about godliness in your life. So I want you to know, point number one, every storm you're going to face is a part of your process. Paul didn't understand the journey was going to entail or have him encounter a storm. People wanted to kill him in the storm. People had plans, but God always has a plan. If you look at this, there was a captain on that ship, a natural captain from Rome. But Paul ended up being the captain and taking the leadership role, even though he was in chains. Come on, somebody. You got to understand there's people in your life that think they have a greater position than you do. They have more knowledge than you do. But when you have Christ as the navigator of your life, when you have Christ and the Holy Spirit guiding you and leading you into all truth and understanding, there'll be people that wear the badge of captain, wear the hat of captain, and they might even have their hand on the wheel of the ship. But let me tell you something. When a storm hits, it's the voice and the reason of God that man will turn to. And if that voice is coming through you, that in turn makes you the captain of somebody else's ship. I want to encourage you tonight. God has a plan. Trust him. Trust him with the plan tonight. So listen, process. Process was never about being comfortable. It was never about your preference. It's all about your development. Write that down. Process is not about your comfort. It's not about your preference. And it's all about your development. So many people die in process because they fight against it. They kick, they fight, they scream, and they keep going around that same mountain over and over again. God will allow you to go through process until the perfecting is done. I told somebody on Sunday afternoon, we used to call that in the old church, the refiner's fire. That process is meant to burn away, which is unlike God, to make us more godly. So don't fight it, because so many people can lose themselves in the fight against God's process. But God says, if you trust me, I'll bring you through. Conform to it, rest in it, trust in God. Learn to navigate your storms, not negotiate. That's a PowerPoint right there. You need to write that down. You have to stop negotiating. How many of you in your prayer life, you're constantly negotiating with God? Let me tell you what it sounds like. Sounds a little something like this. Sounds like, oh God, if you just get me out of this situation, I'll do this for the rest of my life. How many of that have cried that out? God, if you just get me through this hangover and get me through this puking, then I'll just serve you for the rest of my life. I'll never drink again. God, if you just pay my light bill this time, I'll be faithful in my tithe and offering. Quit negotiating with God. Listen, you got to learn how to navigate the storm. God doesn't always want you to be a victim. Come on, somebody. He said we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. He said he gave us the victory. So we have to quit taking that role where we're in bondage. I'm not in bondage. I'm a leader. I am the head. I'm not the tail. I am a leader. I'm not a follower. I serve the Lord. I am victorious. Come on, somebody. I'm a king's kid. You're a leader. Take the lead. Quit taking the back seat. Quit trying to hide behind somebody else. Learn to take control of your situation. Trusting in God, knowing who you are in Christ, resting in Christ, looking at it through God's eyes, you have to learn to navigate. When I was in police college, it was so funny because they took us out on the course where we had to learn to drive our police cruisers. And it was the middle of January. It was slick with ice. This was what the instructor told me. He said to the whole class, he said, I want you to get through this course without hitting anybody. Obviously, they were dummies set up on the track, not real people. Taking out any signs, just get through the course. What did people do? They got out on the course and they tried to get through the course as fast as they could. But if you listen to the instruction was just get through the course without causing any more damage, taking out signs, taking out the dummies, just finish the race. Listen, that's what God wants for us. It's not a race of speed, it's a race of endurance. God wants us to get through it with his instruction, doing it his way and not leaning to our own understanding, but doing it his way. That's what it means for you to navigate the storm. They laughed at me that day on that course But I was the one that got the pat on the back. Because if you go back to that movie, Police Academy, I was that little chick that was singing, driving through. La, 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 la. Everybody laughed at me, but I didn't spin out. I didn't hit any dummies, and I didn't take out any signs. Follow the instructions. It's not about speed. It's about endurance. It's about navigating and taking all of the factors into account while you're going through your storm. Amen? Remember, external, internal, and spiritual. I want to talk to you for a minute tonight about those external storms. Look, we should be experts by the external storm right now. There's people that have been going through COVID-19. There's people who have been going through the illness and the death of loved ones, not because of that pandemic. That's just part of an external storm. Some of you have been going through relational storms, how people treat you. You're okay, but they're coming against you externally. Some of you have been dealing with financial hardship, external storms. Those are like the waves hitting against the rock. When an external storm comes, it's hitting you outwardly. It's not affecting you inwardly. Look, people can look at you and say, what's different about you? How come you're not panicking because you're about to go back into a closed environment in the factory? All the factories are starting to open back up. People are becoming frightened and afraid, and anxiety coming in about being in close quarters with other people. All these things, pressure from the outside. I know you understand pressure from the outside, between finances, relationships, your job, your health, your friends, your family. It's called life. Life has a way of putting external pressure on you. And the enemy wants that external pressure to press on you so much as a believer that it becomes an internal issue. But what the devil intends for evil, God intends for good. Because God will allow that external pressure to come on you, that external storm to come on you. And he said, all things work together for the good. It's that external pressure that will reveal to you as a believer what's going on in you internally. That pressure from the outside will bring to your attention some areas in your life, in your mind, how you view things, your faith. It will bring up issues that you are now revealed with. I need to work on that. I don't have as much patience as I thought I did. I don't have as much trust as I thought I did. I don't have as much faith as I thought I did. See, those external pressures serve a purpose. The enemy wants them to destroy you. But God is going to use those external pressures to elevate you. He's going to use it to reveal to you. See, the Word of God tells us, have a sane estimation of who you are. What does that mean, Pastor Kim? That means you have to know your strengths and your weaknesses. You have to know the areas of vulnerability in your life, and you have to know the areas where you know that isn't even a temptation to me. You have to have a sane estimation. Nobody knows you like you. Nobody knows what you struggle with in the midnight hour. God knows, but nobody else knows. You know, but nobody else knows. Those are those external pressures. When your laptop's laying next to your bed and you're being tempted to get on it and talk to that old flame. Come on, somebody. Especially when your spouse got on your nerves all day. You want to go on Facebook, go on some kind of chat room so that you can find somebody that will make you feel like Mufasa. Listen, it's a temptation. It's an external pressure that's taken place that's triggered and revealed an internal storm that exists but doesn't rage in you every day. Come on, somebody. Yet it can be detrimental to everything that your life is built on. I want to encourage you today, recognize it, identify it, learn to navigate it. So let's look at this. Storms usually show up about halfway between where you're at and where you're going. The journey never starts with a storm, not always. It's when you kind of get into things and things start going really good that you'll recognize all of a sudden things begin to shift. I say it's when God says, okay, I've kept you protected. I've kept the kid gloves on you. I've treated you like a little baby. I've coddled you. Come on, little baby, right? And then God says, but now it's time to come off milk. It's time to grow up. It's time that you grow so that people aren't always teaching you, but you become the teacher. Come on, somebody. You can't always stay an infant and be in that pity party and say, well, they made me do it, or he said it first. God wants us to rise up so that we can be used by him for his glory to reach other people in the world. So that storm will begin to show up. The enemy wants it to uproot you, but God said, through it, I'm going to get you grounded and rooted in this faith that you'll become immovable, unshakable, like your Savior. I'm going to show you that you'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of living water, that when you tap your root system into me, there'll be such a nutrient, there'll be such an anointing, there'll be favor, there'll be blessing, there'll be power. You'll be able to stand in the midst of adversity where you never thought you'd be able to stand. You'll be able to withstand the attacks of everyone coming against you, of life coming against you. You'll be able to stand. You won't bow, you won't bend, and you will not break, but you will stand. That's what the storm creates. So halfway through, as you enter into this journey, all of a sudden, a storm will show up. That storm will be the center of your decision. That storm, that eye of the storm, what it does, it begins to reveal to you just who you are and just how committed you are. Storms will always present to you options. Any options you had in the back of your head about partway through, that's where you can look back and you can still see the land, but you can look out and see nothing in front of you. Let that sink in for a minute. When you step into something, do you step in and go into the deep, or do you try and stay in the shallows where it's safe? Do you try and stay close enough to the land that you can get back to what you left? Or will you go all in so that you can press across and see what God has for you in front of you? That's that moment. It reveals to you, am I totally committed to the plan of God? Or do I still rely on my own plan more than I rely on his plan? It's in that halfway between where I'm at to where I'm going. Some of you tonight are there. And I want to encourage you right now, don't go back. There's nothing behind you worth living for. Everything that God has for you is in front of you. All of your blessings, all of your promise, all of your victories, all of your promotions, all of the relationships you want. Everything that God has for you, it's in front of you. I'm telling you, God is a God that keeps his word. He says he watches over his word to ensure that it comes to pass. God is a promise keeper. He's not a promise maker and then a promise breaker. He's a promise maker and a promise keeper. God will keep his promise even when the wind's blowing, even when the skies are dark. It does not nullify the promise and the word of God, but it should at that moment in your mind and in your heart solidify who he is. It's in that moment and at that point you begin to declare with all authority, because now you're navigating. Come on, you're not negotiating. That's when you start praying like this. God, you said that you would get me through to the other side. God, you said that this storm couldn't destroy me. God, you said no weapon formed against me would prosper. God, you said I would be above and not beneath. God, you said I would be the lender and not the borrower. God, you said I would walk on deadly things and they would not harm me. God, you said. It's when you're in that point with God that you're so confident in his promise, you get fixated on him. You set your chin like flint. You set your eyes on the mark of the prize of the high calling, and there's no looking back. There's no turning back. There's no going back. Me and my husband always say, we know what God delivered us from. Woo! Give me the Holy Ghost chills right there. And some of you know what God delivered you from. And it's in that knowing what God delivered you from that will determine whether you're even tempted to go back. There's nothing behind me that is greater than what's in front of me. I know that the enemy had a plan to take my life, but by the power and the grace of God, listen, God is the authority over life. No man gives it and no man can take it. God is the author. So listen, there's nothing behind me that is greater than what's in front of me. Think about that for a minute. If you need to put that little slogan on your mirror, on your fridge, that little inspirational thing, there is nothing behind me that is greater than what's in front of me. You will get through this storm. And when you get on the other side of it, you're going to look back and you're going to thank God for it. Right now, you know, you can't see where you're going to thank God for it, but I guarantee you, you're going to thank God for it. Thank you, Lord, for taking me down that path. Thank you, God, for taking me through that storm. Thank you, God, for showing me that you're a way maker and a promise keeper. Thank you, God, for showing me my destiny. Thank you, God, because now I have more faith. I am anchored in you, God. I know that nothing or anyone, anything that comes against me is greater than you. Thank you, God. I don't have to be in fear. That's why Jesus could say, no man takes my life. I lay it down because I'm the navigator of this. Me and my kids were laughing today as I was talking about this, and my husband used to walk through the house and say, I'm the captain of this ship. I run this ship. And all of us used to laugh and we'd crack up laughing about it because this is the way he said it. We would laugh. But you know what? He was navigating our family. He wasn't negotiating. He was navigating. You get that when you understand and you get through storm after storm, then you'll begin to see the power and the anointing. But even more than that, the faithfulness of God. God is faithful. He's merciful. He's patient, he's kind, he's loving, and he will keep you and sustain you. Listen, you might not get there with the ship all in one piece like Paul did with the rest of the crew, but guess what Paul said? Did you catch the promise in that scripture? Not one of you will lose your life, not even a hair on your head. Come on, somebody. Now that's powerful right there. Not one of you will lose your life. This storm is not going to kill you. It's going to make you. Every time you feel like this storm is going to kill you, you need to look in the mirror and say, this storm is not going to kill me. It's going to make me. I'm not even going to lose any hair over this thing. But in matter of fact, I'm going to grow some hair. How many have grown hair over this pandemic? I know right now I got a duck tail going on in the back, somebody. Come on, my hair is probably the longest it's been in a long time. My husband is carrying on, y'all. Come on, somebody. But you have to understand, God is that detailed. He even cares about the hair on your head to get you through the storm. So, number two is that the storm will show up a little ways in your journey. Doesn't always show up at the beginning. So enjoy those moments of rest and know that there's another wave coming. Come on. But number three, that which is trying to sink you is actually going to elevate you. Woo, I love that right there. What you thought was going to take you down and sink you is actually a setup to elevate you. Why? A few of the reasons I just said, but even more so, you'll gain a trust. Trust is like buoyancy in water. Come on, somebody. You know that movie, Hope Floats? It gives you hope. It gives you trust. It's all those things that will begin to raise you up to elevate you above your circumstances. I'm talking about the elevation where you're able to navigate your storm, not necessarily a promotion initially, but it's an elevation where everything else that is affecting everyone else, everything that they're being hit with, it's not having the same effect on you. You're looking like, why are they so upset? Can't they see? Don't they know that God is with them? Don't they know that we're going to be okay? We're going to get on the other side of this? Don't they know that God is in control? Don't they know? See, that frame of thinking and that way of talking doesn't just happen. It's brought through process. It's brought through going through a storm. It's brought through circumstances and developing it out of you. Hope floats, people. Listen, it will elevate you and bring you to a place where you have a confidence knowing that nothing that comes against you is going to overtake you. It will give you the mentality like David where you can run into a battle with a Goliath because you know who's with you. It will give you a confidence of knowing that I can go into a lion's den like Daniel and lay and use a lion as my pillow. Come on, somebody. Put your head on a lion and go to sleep. That thing that's roaring in your life, that thing that's trying to intimidate you, keeps yelling in your ear, keeps blowing in your face, listen, lay down on it and rest on it. Elevate yourself above it through the storm. It's not going to sink you. It's not going to break you. It's going to elevate you. Somebody is about to mount up, come on somebody, on wings of eagles. When you're able to soar above the situation, soar above the storm, I'm telling you, there's a beauty in that. There is a beauty in having the ability to be like an eagle. When God makes reference to us about things like that, there's power in that. Where an eagle will fly and elevate himself above the wind and the rain. He'll elevate himself to an altitude that would kill other birds, but not the eagle, not the eagle. I want you to know tonight that God is going to keep you in the storm. You might be going through that external storm. Maybe you're the one that's going through an internal storm. Maybe you're faced with a spiritual storm right now. But I want to encourage you and let you know, mount up on wings as eagles. Soar above, elevate yourself above the storm. Get in the presence of God. Rest in him and know, God, he'll come under you and take care of it. He'll gird you up. He'll lift you up. You don't have to fight the waves. You don't have to fight and try and survive if you just learn to rest in him. Look, there's much more of this sermon, and we're going to continue it on Sunday, but I want to close with this statement for you tonight. God gave me a vision one time of myself, and I was in water, and the water was very turbulent. It was moving, and there were rocks, and I was swimming. I was trying to get away from the rocks. I was trying to get to safety, and that was a very frightening vision for me because I'm not a strong swimmer. Come on, somebody. You can be weak in situations. And as I was struggling, this small voice said to me, rest in me, rest in me. And all of a sudden, as I laid back in that turbulent water, my body began to be navigated through what seemed like was gonna dash me against the stones, was gonna take my life, was gonna drown me, but I just navigated through. And I was resting in God. It wasn't me. My decision in it was I wasn't going to try and negotiate with God. I was going to trust him. I was going to rest in him. And he elevated me in the midst of a turmoil situation. Come on, somebody. He can elevate you. So tonight, I want you to be encouraged. This storm's not going to last always. You're going to come out of it. And when you come out of it, you're going to come out greater. You're going to come out stronger. You're going to come out with clearer thinking. You're going to come out free from the things that had you bound. And God's going to elevate you in him. So I wanted you to send in prayer requests tonight. Send in all those prayer requests. We're going to be praying for you. We're praying for the Davis family and their loss. We're praying for the Elliott family and the loss of their loved one. The Harris family, we're praying for you. We love you, all of those that are struggling. We love you. We're praying for you. Len, God is going to touch your body and bring healing to your body. You're not going down like this, my friend, but he's going to bring you through. You're going to elevate the testimony you're going to have. Don't you let the devil take your joy. You are going to come out. You are going to live and you shall not die. Come on, somebody. This is the power of the God we serve. So I love you tonight. Remember, you're going to make it through. You're not going to just go under, but God's going to bring you over. We'll see you here Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Bishop will be back in the house, and we're going to close this sermon out for you. God bless you. We'll see you soon.